Hello friend. Yeah, today my lecture is on assessment of spinal cord injury. It's a very important point, a very important topic. Here we have the so many spinal cord injury cases in our India, and that is also increasing because of the so many causes. Most commonly like traumatic injuries. Therefore, we need to evaluate each spinal cord injury patient very detailed. So the assessment of it before going to the treatment is very, very important part of the spinal cord injury rehabilitation. So we go through the assessment in detail. First, we go to the incidence. Approximately 55% of spinal cord injury occurs in the cervical regions, 15% at the thoracic region, 15% thoracolumbar junction area, and 15% at the lumbosacral area. So out of that, approximately 10% of patients with the cervical spine fracture have a second non-contiguous vertebral column fracture. So approximately 1/3 of the patients with the upper cervical spine injuries die at the injury site only because of the apnea caused by the loss of the central innervation from the phrenic nerve, that is the innervation from C1, C2, C3. When the fracture dislocation occurs at the thoracic spine, then it almost results in a complete cord injury because it has a relatively narrow spinal canal in thoracic area compared to other regions. So this is the only site where is the possibility of the complete injury, most commonly at the thoracic spine. So if we go to the pathophysiology and mechanics, so the primary injury that is, and the secondary injury. If you go to the primary injury of the spinal cord, that is a direct insult to the neural elements, occur at the time of the initial injury, okay, when the injury happens. Second injury, because of that injury, what happens in that cord, that is called secondary injury, that is hemorrhage, edema, ischema results from the biochemical cascades, that causes secondary injury. And activated by the hypotension, hypoxia, the spinal instability and the persistent compression to the neural elements. These are the features of the secondary injury. And the trauma causes a variety of injury patterns in the spine. There are so many mechanisms of action of the spinal injury. They may be the flexion or extension, compression or distraction, and rotational. There is a combined force. If there is a flexion or extension, then flexion loads the spines anteriorly, like towards the vertebral bodies, and distraction spine posteriorly, the spinous process and interspinal ligaments, which are available at the posterior sides. But if it is a compression or distraction, the force applied along the spinal axis means compresses the spine. Okay, it is axial loading from the head to the toe. And third is a rotational cause. The force applies in the tangential to the spinal axis and rotate the spines, okay, beyond its normal limits and lead to the injury. So what are the classification? The most commonly spinal cord injury classified into as the four levels. First is the level wise. Second is severe to neurological deficits. Third is spinal cord syndromes of the complete and incomplete injuries. And four is the morphology. If we go to the assessment part, here we have the patient's assessment. We must take the relevant history and the physical examination. So the first part is the patient assessment. So how you have to assess the patient? The spine should be initially immobilized on the assumption that the average trauma patient has a spinal injury until it is proven through the radiological investigations. So if the patient is unconscious, the definite clearance of the spine may not be possible in initial stages. So the spinal immobilization should be given until the MRI or the CT scan or equivalent and investigation to be ruled out for the unstable injuries. So the patient who have no findings on examination, demonstrates no decreased level of the consciousness and have no destructive injuries, they can undergo clearance of the spine by clinical means alone. So in that patient, we can sit and move to the hospital. All the plain radiograph, like simple x-rays, okay, are acceptable with high quality images, high definition images, and the reliability also with the CT scan also a very important role. And have they made this modality of choice in the emergency departments. Second part is the relevant history. We must know about the mechanism of the injury and at the site and what the type of injury. So the mechanism and the velocity of the injury, how forcefully he fall down or he is struck with the accident, What is there any prevalence of the spinal pain in the patient site of injury? Is there any onset of neurological symptoms developed or started, like weakness or loss of reflexes, okay, loss of the sensations that you have already started at the site? And if you started, then what is the duration of the neurological symptoms? This is a very relevant, very important relevant history. Okay, last and the final important part of the assessment is the physical examination. You need to touch the patient and you do to have to perform this physical examination. So initial assessment takes over about a careful examination of the identification of the shock. The patient is initially after the injury, he may be any three types of the shocks under, like hypovolemic shock, it may be under neurogenic shock, or he may be under spinal shock. So entire spine must be palpated, overlying skin should be palpated for any cut or any abnormality, and also formal roll on to be performed to achieve this. If you want to examine, you must have to roll the patient to the side. So possibly you can roll to up to max 20 degree. If you cannot able to check properly, then you have to roll it to 90 degree. Okay, but don't roll beyond 90 degree, and the rolling will be in a log roll. Means you have to move the head and the upper limb, shoulder girdle and the pelvic girdle with the both the limbs at the same time with the help of the minimum three people. So without disturbing the alignment of the spine, that you have to examine the spine. Now we go to this three types of shock. What is neurogenic shock? Neurogenic shock results from the impairment of the descending sympathetic path in the cervical or the upper cervical spine cord, upper thoracic spinal cord. This condition results in the loss of the vasomotor tone and sympathetic innervation to the heart. So whenever there is a neurogenic shock, there will be loss of the sympathetic innervation to the heart. It leads to the bradycardia and also leads to the loss of the vasomotor tone and vasodilatation of the blood vessel segments. Therefore, it leads to the hypotension. So this neurogenic shock is seen when there is injury to the cervical or the upper thoracic spine. Right. Then you have the classical patient of neurogenic shock is the hypotension, the setting of the warm, red perfuse extremities in the paralyzed patient. From physical examination, we feel that warming in the extremities, that may be the symptoms of neurogenic shock. Second is the spinal shock. There is an initial loss of all the neurological function below the level of the injury. When that injury happens, the first stage of the injury, immediately after injury, it is stage of the spinal shock. This is a stage where how can identify that this patient has spinal shock? There will be stage of the areflexia, all the reflex will be absent, tone will be decreased, hypotonic, and all the four extremities will be paralyzed. There will not be any movement. Usually it lasts for 24 hours following the spinal injury. Once, how you come to know that spinal shock has over in the patient? Some patient may take more than 24 hours also. So how you identify the spinal shock stage has over? You have to go for check the Burbo-Kevanes reflex. If the reflex, this is the first reflex to come back, or it is a sign to show that the spinal shock stage is already completed. So this is the first sign you can check in the patient, the spinal shock stage has completed or not. That is by eliciting Burbo-Kevanes reflex. If the reflex counts positive, it shows that spinal shock stage has over. Next, in the spinal examination, enter spine will be palpated. Overlying skin should be palpated. As I already told you, for that you have to need to form a log roll. Right? So these are all the three parts. Okay. We see in the assessment, patient assessment, relevant history, and physical examination. Okay. Now we will go to the next part is the neurogenic examination. So in the neurogenic examination, the American Spinal Cord Injury Association, it has given the internationally accepted method of the neurological examination. The scale name is the ASIA scale. That is called the American Spinal Cord Injury Association scale. This is a system of the test used to define. In this scale, after doing this scale, you will come to know about what is the extent of the injury, how much is the severity of the injury, what will be the, on the basis of this, you can also decide for the future rehabilitation of the patient, and also you have the idea about the how will be the recovery. So it is a well-accepted scale in spinal cord injury patients. The scale must have to be taken in any spinal cord injury patient. So if you go to the spinal ASIA scale, there are the steps in this classification. The first step is it determines the sensory level, both the left side and right side you have to take. You also have to determine the motor levels on the both the sides. You also have to take to determine neurological levels of the injury and determine whether the injury is complete or incomplete. And fifth component of it, it is determine ASFN scale grade. How much the last time you got the grade? So this is the full scale. Okay, here it has a four, there's a ABCD, five gradings. According to the gradings, we come to know what are the clinical syndromes available to the patient. The central cord is the Brown Shifter, the anterior cord, conomatotidis, or the cord equina. For that, there's a standard example. You can see here it is a motor part. Okay, here the key muscles are given from the starting from the C2 to the last to the C4, S4 and S5. It is on the left and right side. Both sides have to do the score. With a total score here given here, maximum is out of 50. Here you have to take the MMT. Okay. Right? And according to that, you have to give the grading of the, all the muscles from the site of injury to the lower to the injury. And you have to write down the score and summarize the score of the left side and right side. The maximum score is 100. Similarly, here you have the sensory scale. Key sensory points are given. According to the dermatomes, you have to scale out of 3. This 3 is almost not available. This is the less of the sense. First is the impaired, and 0 is the no sense. First is the impaired sense. Second is the normal sense. Okay, if not able to elicit the sensation, then you can write the anti. On that, you have to check the two sense, there's light touch and the pin prick touch. So you have to check the form again from C2 to S4, S5, left and right side, both the sides, about the both these sensations, and that is a score, total score. It is already given. 54 is the highest. 54 also is the highest. So you can go here. So pin prick highest score is 112, and even light touch score highest is 112. Here, from that level, you can come to the neurological level, left and right, sensing motor. Here also you can know it is complete or incomplete. If it is an incomplete injury, there will not be any sensation at the cellular areas. If it is incomplete, you must have structural sparing. Then you also can give the impairments, that is, you also can know about the zone of passer innervation. Okay, and also you can grade on the left and right. Right, so this is a well accepted scale for any spinal cord injury patient. So as for this level of the neurological impairments, scale is based on the Frankel classification of spinal cord injury. A is the complete, B is the sensor present on the motor absent. On the grade 3, it is sensor present, motor present, but grade is less than 3 out of 5 in the muscles. When the grade neurological impairment grade of the ACL is B, then the sensation is present, motor is also having the functional movements, that is a grade is 3 out of 4. And E means patient has a normal function. Grade may be the 4 or 5. So this is the how you can come to A, B, C, E. There is a neurological impairment levels of the ACR scale. Fine. Next to the management. So this is the management from the primary survey and research situation. How do you assess the spinal? First, we have to check for the airways. Please check for the airways. It is you always find it may be the cervical spine injury. And according to that only you have to take the assessment, because you may not know where which spine is injured after the trauma. So you have to think that it may be the cervical spine injury, and you take the full assessment. So without disturbing the cervical spine, you need to know about the assess the airways, and you have to establish the definite airway, it is needed or not. For the airway, you can also check the airway in such a way that it does not disturb the spine. So for that, you can use the jaw check tactics also. In jaw check technique, you take this jaw in the anterior side from the one thumb and make the patient airway open. If possible, I will show the video also later on. Second is step you have to check for the breathing. Check for the adequate oxygenation, and if the patient is not breathing, there is not sufficient oxygenation, you can check for the oxygen saturation level. If it's not up to the limit, it is less than 80, you must have to make the patient on ventilator support. Then third step, you have to check for the circulation. If the patient has a hypotension, then you should have to differentiate between hypovolemic shock, okay, from the neurogenic shock. Right. According to that, you have to give the patient circulatory part, and you have to replace the fluid for if they have hypovolemic shock, right? You have to replace with the fluids by giving the intravenous fluids. If the spinal cord injury is present, fluid resection should be guided by the monitoring center venous pressure. When performing the rectal examination before inserting the urinary catheter, assess for the rectus meter tone and sensation also. Okay, so these are the important part of the third step, that is the circulation. Fourth step, you have to check for the disability. Here you have to take the brief neurological examination. In that includes level of the consciousness. You also can assess the pupils reflex. You also have to check for the patient's consciousness scale, that is Glasgow Coma Scale, and also recognize it is a paralysis or paresis. Means it is already it is a weakness of the limbs, or it is already paralysis of the limbs. Means the limbs are not moving. So in the secondary survey, okay, you have to obtain ample history. The first step in the secondary survey, it is history, and you have to check for the mechanism of the injury. It is very, very important. You also have to check the medical history if the patient has any prior medical problems like BP or diabetes or any other thyroids or any other metabolic disease or any other orthopedic problems like the cervical spondylosis, rating pain or TB spine. Everything you have to search out the previous medical history. Identify and record drugs given prior to the patient's arrival and during the assessment and management phases, if any drug has been given to him before they shifted the patient to the hospital. Also reassess level of the consciousness at the hospital, and also check for the pupil when coming to the hospital. You also have to reassess for the Glasgow Coma Scale and assess the whole spine. You starting from the palpation again posteriorly by carefully log rolling the patient and check for any deformities, swelling, crepitations, increased pain with the palpation, if there's any contusion, lacerations, or any penetrating wound, if any type of a knife or gunshot wound, that it may be penetrating. So to check for that, you also have to check for the pain, paralysis, and paresthesia. This is abnormal sensation. Is it present or not present? If it is present, then what is the location? And you have to check for the neurological level. So we later on, we come to know how to check the neurological level compared with the spinal level. The third test, you have to check for the sensations. That is a pinprick and light touch. That is on the dermatomes level. And almost you check for the most caudal dermatome. Okay, that the patient feels the pinprick sensation. It means the most distal level of the dermatome where the patient gives answer, I can feel. And beyond that, I am not able to feel. That is the last part of the innervation of the neurological level. You can check for the motor function also as well. The last motor myotome to be innervated by the normal neurological level. According to that also you can come to know about the neurological level. You can check, that is very important part is deep tendon reflex. Okay, it is very important, okay, to check for it is a patient is a spinal shock or not, and which are the levels. But in emergency, with immediately acute stage, you know it is spinal shock, there will be a reflex. So that will be least important of this reflexes in the initial stage of the assessment. And lastly, you have to document everything about the neurological examination, motor sensory examination, okay, and it should be repeated every a few hours or and a day to day. And then lastly, reassess for the all other injury or associated injury to the head or the other parts of the extremities. So the first principles of the patient with the spinal injury. When the patient is suspected with the injury, it must be protected from further injury. Because you know more than 50% of the patient having the spinal cord injury, they are because of the bad transfer or improper transfer from the site of injury to the hospital. So it may develop the secondary injuries, and secondary injuries may be sometimes more dangerous than the primary injuries. So you have to apply that immobilizing cervical collar, semi-rigid, long back bar, perform the modified log roll to enroll that neutral alignment of the spine is maintained by shifting the patient from the site of injury to the stretcher and from stretcher to the ambulance and ambulance to the hospital. Okay, and removing the patient from the long spine board as soon as the possible. Paralyzed patients who are immobilized for the long spine board at a particular risk for the pressure source and the decubitus ulcer. So it a patient possess also to be must to be maintained, and every time it should be turned regular intervals by maintaining the spine stable unless until it is not ruled out for any instability. The paresis patients should also be removed from the long spine board as soon as possible. But the spine injury is diagnosed, and it must be diagnosed within 2 hours of the injury for the better prognosis in future. Second step, you have to start with the fluid resuscitation and monitoring. You have to check for the CVP monitoring. You have to insert the urinary catheter initially when the patient is unconscious. If it is conscious but not able to pass urine, then you have to go for the urinary catheter because to prevent the bladder distension or any type of urinary restrictions. And the third one is a gastric catheter. The patient may not be able to take any food from the mouth. You have to must the patient make the on either the nasopharyngeal tube or the oropharyngeal tube for the gastric for the food intake or liquid. Right? So these are some of the complications the patient may have, like the pain, spasticity, after dysreflexia. Okay, if the lesion is above the T6 level, neurological deteriorations, thromboembolic events, it may be the osteoporotic, hypertrophic ossifications or contractures. There are so many complications also can occur. So this is all about this spinal cord assessment. Okay, so this is all about the brief assessment of the spinal cord. So now we show how you localize that level of the injury in the spinal cord. So you know this is a basic spinal cord. Okay, you can see the cervical vertebra, thoracic, lumbar, sacrum. So all the dermatomes you can see here. You know already there are 31 segments. The embryological development of the child from the growth as the cord lags behind. Okay, so it matures at the level of the L1, and the final cord spinal cord ends at the level of the L1 lower end of the vertebra. The spinal cord injury above this lesion, okay, above the C7, it leads to scotiphagia. Below that, it leads to the paraplegia. In the cervical cord, if there is an upper cervical cord injury, it will be the scotiphagia plus weakness of the diaphragm. Because of phrenic nerve C1, 2, 3 supplies the diaphragm. So, patient will have the problem with the breathing also. In the upper cervical injury, if the injury is the C4, C5, it will be the quadriplegia. If it is the injury is the C5, C6, the biceps may be spared. And you can know about the main important symptoms. C5 is the biceps innervation, C7 is the extension of the elbow, okay, and the shoulder. And C8 is a flexus of the shoulder. This is a thoracic cord. You can briefly identify the levels. Is the level of the segmental level. It is a T4. Shows the nipple area. Umbilicus a T10 area. Okay. And you can check for the sensory levels. And also check for the disturbance of the bobbin and bladder habits. If you go to the lumbar cord, it is L2 to L4. If there is injuries at this level, there will be paralysis of the flexion and abduction of the thigh, plus there is a weakness of the leg extension at the knee, and the patellar reflex will be lost. There is a knee jerk will be lost. Okay, this is the level of the injury, and what will findings you find? If the injury is at the L5 S1 level, the movement of the foot and ankle will be affected, and flexion of the knee, extension of the thigh, and ankle jerk will be lost. If the injury is at the conus medullaris, so bilateral serial anesthesia will be seen in S3 to S5 level. Bowel bladder dysfunction will be there. Importance will be there in the mill. And morbo cavernous and a reflex will be absent. But the muscle strength will be preserved. And when you do the coda equina, there will be the low back pain. Because coda equina is a type of the peripheral nerve injury, symptoms will be there. Asymmetrical leg weakness will be there. Sensory loss. A reflexia in the lower extremity. But there will be sparing of the bowel and bladder function. Okay, so first identify that. First, you have to find for the check for the distribution of the root pain. Ask for the specific dermatome to be involved and due to the involvement of the posterior nerve roots. You can see here, you have to first find out which nerve roots is affected by going to the different dermatomes level. You can see here in the hand, okay, in the lower abdomen region, in the groin region. You can see in the upper thigh region, fine. You can see in the lower leg region, foot region, okay. And this is a whole about the dermatomes of the posterior side of the body too. But according to that, you can find out the root level. the back of the leg and back of the foot. Right. So if the upper part of the sensory loss is there, the axon will pass from the below upwards for the dermatomal of the upper part of the sensory loss. We could due to the affection of the spinothalamic nerve. There is a pain and temperature. The girdle-like sensations or the signs of the constriction of the layer of the lesion, you know, it may be there also because like proprioception and kinetic sensation will be lost because of the damage to the posterior column. There will be zone of the hyperesthesia or hyperalgesia. Okay, it may be also present because of compression of posterior root. You have two localized layers of the lesion, one segment below. There is a zone of the hyperesthesia. Okay, that may be the level of the injury, below jet level, one segment level low. Okay, you can find there will be the hypersensitivity. There will be insensitivity at the level of the injury. Immediately after one level below, there will be the hypersensitivity or hyperalgesia. That call is a zone of the hyperalgesia or zone of the hyperalgesia. You also to check for the abdominal reflex. The upper abdominal reflex is the innervation is the T7 to T9. If it is intact, then check for the middle abdominal reflex, that is a T9 to T11. And also you can check for the lower abdominals, innervation level is a T11 to T12. Okay, sites of incidence most probably by T10 spinal segments, you find this. There will be the upper abdominal segment will be intact, but loss of the middle and lower abdominal segment. If the T10 is a site of injury. You also check for the atrophy of the muscles, if anterior onset is involved. You also check for the deep reflexes. Okay, because if a particular segment is involved, there will be the reflex will be absent below that at that level of the injury, and below that level of injury there may be the exaggerated. Also check for the Bewer's sign. Okay, in that patient you have to check the patient to lift his head up from the pillow against the resistance. You can see the umbilical movement on the any of the quadrant, upper quadrant, side quadrant, lower quadrant. You can check for the all six quadrants, left side, upper, middle, lower, and right side, upper, middle, lower quadrant. You can see where is the umbilicus moves. The which side the umbilicus moves, that is a normal innervated quadrant. The which side the umbilicus does not able to move, that it calls it is affected. Okay, in a normal patient, it does not move umbilicus, it will be in the central area only. But you have to check for the upper, middle, lower abdominal myotomes or level of injury, then you can check for the Bewer's sign. Is very useful to checking the level of the thoracic spinal cord injuries. You also check for any deformity or swelling in the vertebra, even tenderness in the vertebra. And also you can check for the area of the sweating because you know that above 46 level there will be autonomic dysreflexia, there will be the lake of the sweating below the level of the injury. And you also check for the level also can be identified with the just plain x-ray or myelography, CT scan or the MRI. Okay, so if you want to check, the very important part is to determine the spinal segments in relation to the vertebra. If this level of the vertebra is injured, then what will be the spinal segment will be affected? Because you know, vertebra are the 33 pairs. Okay, but the spinal cord ends at the level of the L1 only. Right, because as the growth develops, spine is increasing the height, okay, but spinal cord remains the same. Therefore, if there is injury at any of the level, then what will be the spinal segment or neurological level will be affected? That you can know about on this basis of this criteria. If the cervical injuries, then you have to add one. Okay, if the cervical is a vertebral level, add one. It is a neurological level. Okay, or it is a segmental level. If the injury is a T between T1 to T6, you have to add two to identify the segmental level. If injury is between T7 to T9 vertebral level, you have to add 3 for the segmental neurological level. If injury is at T10, okay, then the segmental level will be L1 and L2 segments. Injury is a level of T11, then it corresponds to the L3 and L4 segments. And if injury is the T12 level, then it shows the neurological or segment level is at L5. And L1 arch overlies the an injury at the L1 or below. It is damage to the sacral coccygeal segments. Okay. In case of a non-compressive myelopathy, question of the localization of the level of the lesion does not arise. If this is a non-compressive. Okay. You also have to check for the bladder dysfunction in neurological disease. If it is a neurogenic bladder, then urinary bladder receives the nerve supply. You must know that bladder having the nerve supply from sympathetic and parasympathetic. Sympathetic nerve supply is from L1, L2, L3. And that is a
responsible for nerve filling. That is responsible for filling the urine into the bladder. The parasympathetic supply comes from S2, S3, S4, and it is called the nerve of the evacuator. It is responsible for the evacuating the urine out. Right. If there is injury in the sympathetic, there will be problem in the nerve filling. Okay. It directly ejects. If there is an injury in the parasympathetic, then it will be problem with the ejecting, but our bladder will be filling. Filling will be normal. Right. If there is an incomplete lesion, you have to check for precipitancy or hesitancy. If the involvement of the inhibitory fibers are there, it leads to the diagnosis leads to the multiple sclerosis. If the hesitancy, there is a fascity fibers are involved, it shows the incomplete spinal cord compression. If the injury is complete, there will be the two types of the bladder will be possible. First is the retention of the urine. Okay, is a weight is overflow incontinence. It is most commonly seen in neural shock stage of the entire acute transverse myelitis stage. Here, the evacuation of the bladder is usually incomplete. Autonomic bladder, here the evacuation is complete and completely seen in the neurons of the shock stage is over and evacuation occurs by local reflex arc. Here, the frequency, urgency, and urge incontinence will be seen in automatic bladder. So, if the lesion is complete, then there will be the two types of the bladder may be possible. First is the retention of urine with the overflow incontinence, or it may be the automatic bladder. Okay. If the lesion is at the local reflex arc, okay, then there may be the first type of bladder is the sensipatic bladder. So, what is sensipatic bladder? It is a loss of the awareness of the fullness of the bladder because this is a sensipatic. There will not be any sense of the fullness of the bladder. Okay, and large volume of the urine will be collected in the bladder. Okay, and huge residual volume will be present inside the bladder because there is a lack of the sense of the bladder filling. Okay, if the lesion is a local reflex arc. Second is maybe the motor hepatic bladder. Here there will be the having the sense of the filling the bladder, but patient not able to initiate or continue the maturation. Okay, it is seen the most commonly trauma or pelvic neoplasm patient. Okay, third will be autonomous bladder. It's very common in cauda equina lesions, pelvic malignancy, or spina bifida. So in autonomous bladder, there will be no sensation of the bladder fullness, but continuous there will be the dribbling. Patient will not have any signs of the filling. Okay, but patient will not have a control also, and there will be the continuous dribbling of the urine will be happen, and that dribbling also can be happen with the sneezing or any fast food or any forceful movements also they can lead to the dribbling. Okay, so this was all about the basic about localization of the spinal cord injury level. Okay, when we go to the next, it is a spinal cord injuries overview. Okay, so here you can see this is normal anatomy. Okay, that you already know. This is the fact that male is 85% more common, more prone for the spinal cord injury than the woman. Ages is between of the spinal cord injuries 16 to 30. Okay, in the trauma, if you find the motor weak accident 40%, violence it is 22%, falls is still will be 22%, and the cause of the spinal cord injury in the sports like driving or horse riding will be 8%. Okay, there is a non trauma, the malignancy, infection, vascular cause. Okay, or cord injuries, the cervical is the highest level, it is 60%, thoracic 30, lumbar 4, sacral 2%, most commonly seen the C5, C6, C7, it is greatest mobility at this level. Okay, and 10% vertebral fracture, we have another fracture. When thinking the spine, think of the whole spine, because it is possible there is a fracture in the upper cervical spine as well as in the lower spine also. So, specific lateral injury may also have the other revestic injury. So, therefore, the cord injuries to be found out on secondary survey. So, primary versus secondary, there may be the hypoxia, hypotension, movement, or inflammation. You also know that what is complete versus incomplete. If there's an incomplete injury, there will be preservation and sensorimotor motor function like sacral sparing. So, what are the clinical features of sacral sparing? There's a big toe flexion, perianal sensation, and bubble cranial reflex is present. If it is present, then you can definitely tell that it is an incomplete injury. You know, immediately after spinal cord injury, there will be spinal shock stage. This is just revision for you for all the spinal cord injury. The transient loss of the function below the level of the injury, right? And there will be stage of neural shock where there is functional sympathectomy. There will be decrease in blood pressure and decrease in heart rate. okay, or not respond to the IVH. Okay, if you find there is a hemorrhage in this cord, okay, at a time of injury, it shows as a bad prognosis. And if there is no hemorrhage, okay, after the spinal cord injury, okay, only edema is there, it has a very good, better prognosis. But if there is a hematoma is there, after the injury, it has a very bad prognosis. You can see here, this chart shows motor recovery rate for the patients with the edema alone. Okay, you can see in the blue, if it is only edema, there is non-hemorrhagic damage, is a recovery of prognosis rate is 59%. When there is a hemorrhage, okay, in edema plus hemorrhage, there is only 8% rate of the recovery in the patient. Okay, this is the scale is only shows a lower limb legs recovery. Fine. So, if the length of the injury also very important, if the length of the cord injury, length means level of the injury. If the level of the injury is long, so more of the vertebra is affected, okay, then the prognosis will be bad. If it is not so long, it is only just localized to one particular part, okay, then the prognosis will be good. Okay, you know that all these cord syndromes, incomplete, okay, you know the center cord syndrome, it is a cause of injury, hyperextension, anterior it is a flexion and rotation, Brown's requires a knife in the back on his stab injuries. It leads to the Brown's requires syndrome, which is rare. Posterior cord syndrome is also rare, which involves hyperextension of knife injury. And cord conclusion, the full restoration within 48 hours. Okay, here you can see the center cord syndrome, anterior cord syndrome figure, and Brown's requires syndrome, hemisection of the spinal cord. Okay, here you can see the first one is hyperextension injury. Okay, the cervical spine hyperextension, there's a center cord syndrome. In the center cord syndrome, you can see the hyperextension injury. You can see patient fall from a height and head goes to the hyperextension. So what happened in the hyperextension here? You can see the injuries, how happened. You can see in this figure, hyperextension type of injury, how it affects the spinal cord by posterior impinging the spinal cord. Here you can see the fracture and displacement. The central cord is very common. This happens most in the old people. There will be the osteophytes. Here, what will be the pattern of the affection? It is a motor affection. Arm is more affected than the leg. And the sensory also, in the arm is more affected than the legs because of the lateral cortical spinal tract is involved. Okay, and usually reflexes may vary. And usually, sacral sensory sparing will be there. Okay, this is just a brief revision for you. Next is hyperflexion injuries. Okay, you can see the hyperflexion injury. Okay, it's seen in the anterior cord syndrome. Okay, here you can see a C5-C6 disc bulge. Okay, and here you can see the edema is posteriorly seen. It's a normal spine. And you can see here, this is how the hyperflexion injury is happened. You can see the rupture ligamentum flavum and interspinous ligament is ruptured. Fine. Here you can see different levels of the hyperflexion sprain. Anterior subluxation, fine. Here you can see simple wedge fracture, but it is stable. It is an unstable wedge fracture. You can see it is fracture plus it is unstable. You can see this level. Here there is another type of the hyperflexion injuries, unilateral interfacetal dislocation. You can see here dislocation also associated with the injury. You can hear say bilateral interfacetal dislocation. Both the facet joints are dislocated. Okay, and here you can see flexion teardrop fracture along with the hyperflexion injuries. So different type of hyperflexion injuries photographs. You can very easily identify here. Okay, here's a brief about the anterior cord syndrome. You know it is a cause is the hyperflexion injury. Here you can see anterior spinal arteries compressed. Okay, and primary affection is the motor paralysis. Can involve the cortical spinal tract. Okay, but rarely involves the dorsal column. So, patient will have the proper perception, kinetic sensation or the function of the dorsal column will be, kinetic sensation will be normal. But there will be more of the motor symptoms will be seen. Next, you can see is Brown's requires syndrome. There is a hemisection of the spinal cord. It is very rare, but you can see it is a stab injury. Okay, here the injury is done by the screwdriver. It directly inserted into the spine and the half of the spinal cord is cut. Okay, so it leads to the rotational fracture as well as dislocation. So here in this, there will be the ipsilateral loss of the corticospinal tract function, means ipsilateral loss of the motor function and contralateral loss of the sensory function, the pain and temperature because of the approximately with the spinothalamic tract. You can here and have the revision of the posterior carcinoma. It's also very, very rare because posterior cord is having the butter body. It is very large part, very difficult to damage. But it which damages, there's the posterior function, there's a proper subsection vibration will be lost. Prognosis is very good because patient will be heavily mobile, okay, and it also having the mechanism injury will be the hyperextension of the vertebral vertebral arch fracture. Next, a cauda equina syndrome. It is not a cauda syndrome because it is typically actually lower motor neuron lesion, because after spinal cord ends, after L1 level, whatever injury happens, it is called cauda equina, and in labor injury at that level, it is called cauda equina syndrome. So it having the signs and symptoms of lower motor neuron lesion, loss of nerve plexus, leg weakness, ball bearing dysfunction, saddle anesthesia, loss of anal tone, sexual dysfunction. Okay, and congenital mainly affects the middle age individual, particularly those in their 40s or 50s age. Okay, and present more often in the male. Okay, this is another. It is called spinal cord injury without radio cord abnormality. If the injury is there, the radio cord abnormality is not there. So this is seen in children most commonly. The children with the spinal cord injury, they will not identify on X-ray or CT scan because it is spinal cord injury but without radiological abnormality, right? It is seen in the children with the less than 8 years of age. Okay, here the spine will be more flexible. Okay, so also less likely to have the fracture because bones are still grooving. Okay, so typically seen in the children with the cervical injury. Fine. So how to examine the patient? Okay, they already know the primary survey first, then cauda equina to be picked out, okay, in second survey, okay, and you have to tell, check for head to toe, you have to look for the head, neck and mouth, paradoxical breathing, okay, left seatbelt sign, gross deformity, okay, and if the bilateral Horner syndrome is positive, then the level may be above T1 or sometimes greater than T4 level, okay, feel the midline of the neck and deformity, okay, log roll. Then you can check the log roll on 20 degree if possible. If not able to check fully and you find some suspicion, they only log roll to 90 degree. Examine each modality separately on the all area of the body. Check for the motor grading, check for the sensory, okay, for the soft touch and pain, okay, and the reflex is also only especially anal tone, because I told you immediately after the spinal cord injury there will be the shock stage, so all other peripheral reflexes will be absent, but you can check for the anal tone reflex to identify the, or you will check for the sacral sparing. Okay, fine. Then this is ACI scale. Okay, that already seen. Fine. And this is how you manage that. You already see ABCD approach, X-ray imaging. Okay, we need to give these injections. It's very important to give this steroid methylprednisolone injection within 8 hours for the significant recovery of the motor function, because these injections is prevents the additional trauma, secondary injury to the spine. It resolves the edema which happens due to the spinal cord injury. So the secondary impairment will be reduced if it is a prednisone, this steroid injection given within 8 hours of the injury. But if it is a contaminated wound or bowel perforation or sepsis is there, the injection is contraindicated. Okay. So this is a dose of that. Fine. So here you can see the different type of cervical fractures. So arch fracture. Okay, this anterior arch, posterior arch fractures. You can see here. This is a dense. This is a C1. The C2 spine is dense process. Fine. You can see the facet fracture and the anterior body fracture. Ridge compression fracture. Okay. Fine. So thank you everyone. There is still one more part of the prognosis. Okay, here if you see the prognosis of the patient here, so you can see here what will be the prognosis in this type of patient. If you want to find out the prognosis, it depends on the potency of the recovery, the degree of the pathological changes imposed by the trauma. So prognosis depends on the three things. What are the pathological changes, degree of the pathological changes by the trauma. Second is a precaution taken to prevent the further damage. I told you that during the rescue from the site of injury, how you shift the patient to the hospital. So during that total period, it's not as a rescue period. So what are the precautions you have taken? So that is also depends on the prognosis. And third is the additional stroma compromising neural tissue from hypoxia or hypertension during the acute management. So this whole prognosis depends on these things. So primary prognosis initially after spinal cord shock has subside is guided by whether or not the lesion is complete. Okay. And good prognosis for the incomplete lesion and bad prognosis for the complete lesion. Improvement usually begins after the stoppage of the spinal shock. And at the time, rate of recovery will decrease. And if the plateau is reached, okay, then you can show that, okay, there will be no new muscle activities observed for several weeks or month. So then you can see that there will be the stable sign has already come. So there will not be additional recovery be expected in the patient. If the recovery has stopped or it not going beyond some months or weeks, it is still steady and no new muscles are coming up, then you can feel that the recovery has stopped. Okay, so how you examine? Okay, respiratory examination is very crucial part. Function of respiratory muscles, chest expansion, breathing pattern, is abdominal thoracic or thoracoabdominal. You have to check for the cough efficiency. Patient is able to cough, not able to cough, then he can able to huff. You have to check for the vital capacity. Integumentary means skin level. You have to check for any bed sores. Okay, you have to check for the sensations and tone, hypertonic. DTR, different reflexes, as well as manual muscles testing, range of motion, and functional status. Okay, and intervention is most commonly to make first part is the respiratory management, second to prevent the indirect impairment and complication, third goal should be the maintaining the range of motion, and fourth is the facilitate active movement in available musculature. These are the intervention goals for the active stage, right? So respiratory management, you know all these things. Deep breathing, good supra breathing, arsic maneuvers, strengthening exercise of the abdominal or diaphragm, acidic coughing or huffing techniques, abdominal support while coughing, huffing, stretching to the uninvolved muscles or distal muscles, and chest physiotherapy, right? Range of motion, positioning, very important part. Selective strengthening, which are distal muscles not affecting your spinal stability, they only strengthen that muscles, and orientation to the vertical position. Fine. So must emphasize to be on maximize the functional independent. Okay, we have to make the patient's brain mobility, transfer and wheelchair mobility. Okay, if the possible, you have to make the treatment such a way that basically functionally independent. And progressive skill necessary for active phase from the work, home or community recently. And patient not able to accomplish specific functional task, should be educated, okay, for how to perform with the help of the another person, especially the high cervical lesion. Okay, continue treatment as in acute phase. Okay, educate patient for the skin inspection. Patient gets also set inspection can be done by the mirror of his any base source. You have to start with the after acute phase subside. Patient is stable, is discharged with the braces, okay, or the supported devices. Then you can start with the mat activities. Okay, that is part of rolling, bone on elbow, sitting, task force, all type of activity from a prospective wheelchair. Ambulation, function to stimulation also can be given to the weak muscles. Educate for the prevention, health promotion, fitness and wellness. Okay, so there is no specific acute treatment for spine with patients. So all the treatment based on your assessment and patient's functional level of the availability of the musculature and the senses are intact. So according to that, they have to decide the treatment. Right? Fine. So you know what is the difference between paraplegia and quadriplegia over here. Okay, if the impairment in the motor or sensory function of the lower extremities, that is called paraplegia. If the both upper limb, both the lower limbs are affected, that is called quadriplegia. Only upper limb, it is called monoplegia. So you know that paraplegia is of two types, spastic and flaccid. Paraplegia spastic, it is a paraplegia having the two types of spastic. It is a paraplegia in flexion, paraplegia in extension. In the spastic paraplegia, if the paraplegia is extension, then you must know that the lower limb will be taken extensor attitude. Only pyramid track is involved. Therefore, the paraplegia is developed to spasticity in extension level. And you have to evaluate it early. But if the paraplegia is in flexion, the lower limb take attitude of the flexion. But in this, both pyramid and extremal track also will be involved. Okay, here the evaluation will be done late. Right, this is the main difference between paraplegia and flexion and extension. What are the causes of spastic paraplegia? Okay, there is upper mundodontic type. Then there will be the gradual onset or the delay onset. If it is a sudden onset, if it is a gradual onset, then you can think of the first cause is the cerebral cause. It is a cerebral diplegia or paracerebral meningioma. So in that, there will be a gradual onset of the weakness. And second cause you can find out in the gradual onset, okay, it is a spinal cause. If it is compressive, it is non-compressive. If it is non-compressive, then it may be the motor neuron disease, multiple sclerosis, Friedreich ataxia, or subacute combined degeneration. But if it is a compressive, okay, then it has the intermedullary cause or the extramedullary cause. Intermediary cause is only 5% of the people will have. Cause of that, it will be glioma, ependymoma, or chordoma. But if the cause is extramedullary, then it may be interdural or extradural. Interdural, it's only have the percentage of 15% of the people. We have the meningioma, neurofibroma, or any TB or syphilis of the spine. That leads to the extramedullary cause of the compressive etiology. Okay, in interdural. If the extramedullary, extradural cause is there, which is of most common, 80% of the people will have the extradural, extramedullary cause of the spinal cord injury. It will involve caries spine, lymphoma, metastatic deposits in the vertebra. Also, it may be the patchy meningitis or prolapse intervertebral disc. This is very common. Because of disc prolapse, it can lead to this extradural compression of the cord. Okay, it is a cause of the extramedullary cause of the compressive spinal cord injury. Right, this is, you can see, identify here the scoliosis. Okay, if the patient is having the sudden onset, then you can think about the cerebral causes for the sudden onset. Okay, so sudden onset, yes, the cerebral causes, it may be available in thrombosis of the unpaired anterior cerebral artery or superior sagittal sinus thrombosis. And if you go to the sudden onset of the spinal cord cause, it may be the acute tonsil myelitis or injury to the spinal cord, or then also it can be the sudden cause onset of the symptoms. It may be the thrombosis of the anterior spinal artery, hematomyelia, post vaccinal, or prolapse intervertebral disc. That can also lead to have a sudden onset of the symptoms. Okay, so what are the causes of the flaccid paraplegia? There is element type. Okay, when the UMN type in shock stage, okay, the sudden onset of neurological shock, acute tonsil myelitis, or the spinal injury. Okay, there you can have the causes of the element type of symptoms. You find when this lesion is upon one neuron, but in the shock stage, you find the element type of symptoms. So, element lesion involving the anterior onset of peripheral nerves, then it may be because of acute anterior poliomyelitis, it is available in acute infective polyneuropathy, or progressive muscular atrophy. If it is an element lesion with anterior onset of peripheral involvement, then it may be the diagnosis. Right? And if this is affecting the posterior nerve root and it has the weakness of the limbs, then you can think of the tapes dorsalis. And if this is affecting the mild neural junction, and then you can think of the myasthenia gravis or periodic paralysis due to hyperhypokalemia. Okay, and if this is affecting the muscles, think of the myopathies, and you can also think of the hysterical paralysis. So these are the differential diagnosis of the spinal cord injury. These are all are very important. Fine. So please remember 5 T's. Trauma, tumor, tuberculosis, thrombosis, and transverse myelitis. Okay, so thank you very much. So my next on this level, how to discriminate between the paraplegia and quadriplegia, we'll check in the next slides or next presentation or next class will be on totally on quadriplegic and paraplegics. Okay, so till here I think you are clear. So please refer it again till you get confirmed, because assessment is very important part of the spinal cord injury patients. So without assessment, it is very difficult to identify the prognosis and the treatment. Okay, so thank you very much all. Thank you.